I'm Mark Grauso. I'm manager of Dave's Comics in Ann Arbor here. Dave's Comics 2. We have another store in Royal Oak, and it's been there for 13 years. This store here in Ann Arbor has been here for only 3 years. Dave started buying comics about 1975, 76, when he was right out of high school, working, driving a tow truck, 70, 80 hours a week, made a lot of money. And back then, there were a lot of shows in the Detroit area, conventions. And Dave would just go to these shows and buy entire tables of, you just go up to the dealer and say, I want to buy it all, how much for it, come back an hour later and make him an offer and buy it. So that's how we got the big back stock that we have. We have nearly a million comics in our warehouse. So that's how we started that. Then Dave opened the first store in Royal Oak in 77, or 76. And I had a partner at that time and then bought him out a couple years later. And we had 10 good years in Royal Oak and then had enough money left over to open a store here in Ann Arbor. We picked Ann Arbor because the average, according to the industry, the average comic book reader is 20 to 25. That's perfect for a college town. And this is a perfect college town for comics. We, in Ann Arbor, we're able to sell more of some comics than the rest of the state of Michigan put together. Flaming Carrot Comics, Lovin' Rockets, this store sells more than the rest of the state of Michigan, including our Royal Oak store. And so we like to be able to sell that because those are two of my favorite comics. And it certainly makes it easier when you have more people that are into cool stuff, and this is a good town for that. Pretty open-minded audience. We don't have any trouble with parents getting upset about horror comics or any activist groups complaining about comics being bad for children or any of that sort of stuff. So it's definitely a perfect town for it. And well, I like it here. I've been here for 10 years, so I don't plan on moving out, and I can understand why Dave wanted to put the store here. There's a lot of really good comic book stores in college town, so I think it's just a perfect place to be. So that was 3 years ago. We've had 3 good years here. We just expanded the Royal Oak store. It's now huge. We call it the Taj Mahal of comic stores. It's a gigantic place. As far as comics themselves, well, how are their values determined? A lot of people always want to know how we come up with the prices. There's a magazine called The Overstreet Price Guide, comes out quarterly. Then a large book, the guide itself, comes out once a year. The magazine comes out quarterly. Now these are they come up with the average price, the average retail price, based on interviewing stores around the country. So these prices are just averages. Generally prices in the East Coast and on the West Coast are higher than in the Midwest. Our prices are generally right on guide, depending on what's going on. Like right now with the current Batman craze, I price most of my Batmans a little bit over guide because they just don't stick around. It doesn't matter. I can price them over guide and they still sell. So get a little bit more out of them. Because it is an average, it vary a lot in small towns, in comic book stores in small towns. Quite often, you can find a lot of back issue comics really cheap. The closer you get to bigger cities, the more problem you have finding things because, for one, the demand is higher. There's a lot more people around looking for them, and there just aren't enough. So you tend to be able to set your prices higher when you're in a city than as far as smaller stores out in small towns. Well, there's two things, basically, like anything, that affect the price of comics. It's supply and demand. On the demand side, something like Batman right now, or X-Men comics, or the Justice League comics that are coming out now, extremely popular. There are a lot of them printed, but because they're extremely popular, the prices go up because there's just more and more people read them, mainly people from the age of about 15 to 20 read them, and that's an awful lot of people. So the prices on those tend to rise pretty quickly, but stay level. They don't really go nuts. They just sort of say level increases. That's because there's just so many people that want them. Now, comics like the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles or Lovin' Rockets, these are both independently published black and white comics that when originally published only had print runs of about 2,000, whereas the X-Men, they print about a million X-Men. So something like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles number one is actually very rare. There are There are nearly 5,000 comic book stores in the country, and they only printed 2,000 copies of this comic, so over half of the comic book stores didn't even get one, not even one. So that makes them extremely rare, and say, Turtles number one, although it's only 6 years old, goes for $200 already. Love and Rockets number one is 8 years old, and it goes for about $100 already. It's interesting that the Turtles is generally addressed to a younger crowd, and it's $200. Now, Love and Rockets is an adults-only title, and it's only $100. I don't know where they come up with the money, but they do. Around Christmas time, you sell a lot of early Turtles. In the store here right now, the most valuable comic I have is Human Torch number one. That's coverless, and it looks like it's pretty beat up, but it's still $200. In mint condition, it goes for about $4,000. I'd like to get a hold of one of those, but I've never seen one, even with a cover. So they're genuinely rare. It came out in 1940. It's also probably the oldest comic that I have here in the store right now. In the past few months, we've had Avengers number one, Hulk number one, Spider-Man number one, Amazing Fantasy 15, which is the first Spider-Man appearance. All those were in the $600 to $800 range, except for the Amazing Fantasy 15, which we sold for $2,200 two weeks ago. That was the nicest copy I'd seen of that since I was a kid when it came out. When I was a kid, I collected comics quite a bit. I read basic Marvel comics, Fantastic Four and Captain America. I still read those today. Sometimes, not all the time anymore, not as faithfully as I did when I was a kid. There were older kids in my neighborhood who gave me their comics from the 50s. So I got exposed to weird science and fantasy and the comics from EC Comics. Their only comic now is Mad Magazine, but they used to do some extremely gory and wild science fiction stories with great art, and they're still my favorite comics today. The older kids in the neighborhood tried to scare me with their horror comics, and it worked. I didn't read horror comics again until I was about 25, but I read them now a lot. There's some great ones coming out now, like Sandman and Hellblazer from DC Comics. They're excellent. Very well written and very well illustrated. The interesting thing about the comic book market now, or the product that's coming out at least, for me, it's being written by people who are my age, who were reading the comics that I read when I was a kid, and they're kind of tired of the same old thing, and so they're coming up with some pretty exciting, interesting things. I mentioned Flaming Carrot before. That's probably my favorite comic. I've got all of those, and I had to spend a bit of money to get all of those after Flaming Carrot number one came out in 1980 and now sells for $125. Unfortunately, I didn't get one until this year, so cost a bit. Grendel is a very good comic. It's about the epic battle between Argent, the wolf, and Grendel, the devil, and it's a story that's been, throughout the comic, it's run over a couple hundred years in 30-some issues. That's a fantastic comic, with innovative art and a great storyline. Other great comics today, I mentioned Sandman and Hellblazer. Love and Rockets is fantastic. It's a fairly adult-oriented comic. It's about the punk rock scene in L.A. And it's also about a South American village. There's two stories run concurrently in it. Two brothers from Los Angeles write it. And we had them here in the store for a signing back in April. It was a pretty successful signing, and we were glad to have them. We'll have them out again next year. But I also like funny, goofy comics as well as serious ones. I still read quite a bit, voraciously. As far as old stuff, about the oldest I said we had was Human Torch. That's probably still true. The oldest comic would probably be, oldest running, still running comic would probably be Action Comics, 1939 it started out. Walt Disney Comics, the story started soon after, 1940 or so. But Action's probably the oldest running. Started out with Superman right from the beginning. Okay, well, let's walk around my home away from home here. I'm here 6 days a week, so there's some interesting things I'd like to show you around the store. Okay. This is where we keep the graphic novels and adult stuff and reprinted stuff. European stuff, things like this, They don't quite look like comics used to. This guy's an impressionist painter from Italy, and he writes a great story too, but it looks like nothing you've seen in a comic book before. These are the old undergrounds. They're still coming out. They started out in the 60s, self-published. A lot of them were drug humor, things like that. They're adults only, clearly marked, and in plastic bags, so nobody can get at them. Weirdo and Ripoff have been around for 25 years this year. This is the comic Love and Rockets that I told you about, written by two brothers from Los Angeles, the Hernandez brothers. Their books are available in reprints or in or just in comics. A lot of this stuff is translated from either Spanish or from Italian and French. Over here we have reprints of, these are the EC comics I told you about, the horror comics. This is what started the comic witch hunt back in the 50s. They said that comics were causing kids to be juvenile delinquents. I don't believe that at all. But these comics were the ones that they eventually came up with the Comics Code Authority to prevent comics like this from being around. And these are still my favorite comics of all time. They have the best art and the most fun stories. These were great escapist comics. These here are reprints of Disney stories from the 40s and 50s that were done by Carl Barks, who's the great duck artist of all time. Delightful stories. People all ages buy these. People buy them for their kids, and then they come back and buy more for themselves. Dick Tracy reprints, they're still coming out with, these are all newspaper strip reprints that came out in the 40s and 50s. Over here, we also sell cool stuff, so that's a pretty loose term. We have the Empire Strikes Back lunchbox, a lot of Star Wars things, Fred Flintstone soapy toy, used to have a bubble bath in it. It's empty now, but it's still worth about $10. It's 25 years old. A Zippy the Pinhead doll for Pinhead fans. A lot of Japanese models. In Japan, they make a lot of great models. And whenever we can get a hold of them, we bring them here because a lot of people are dedicated collectors of Japanese models. $6 million man model. Not quite the quality of a nice Japanese model, but who wouldn't want a $6 million man model? We sell old board games, movie or TV related board games, Spirographs. I bought one of those myself, in fact. And Superman dolls, Flip Wilson and Geraldine talking doll that I'm afraid doesn't talk anymore. But it gives you an idea of some of the cool stuff we have. A Donald Duck cereal bowl for a baby. You can't find these everywhere. So that's our cool stuff. And this is my favorite section.
What's
that? That's just some of your goals.
Some. Over here are the two largest companies, Marvel and DC Comics. DC Comics puts out Batman and Detective Comics, Superman and all those comics. This is the Batman movie adaptation there. Hellblazer was the horror book I was talking about that's really good these days. This is great stuff. Down here are the Marvel's the biggest publishing company. They put out Spider-Man, started in 1963. Captain America, he was around during World War II, but they brought him back in 64, I guess. And he's still around now, 25 years later. These are probably the most popular ones for Marvel Comics. Wolverine, who originally started out in the X-Men here. These are all the mutant titles, they call them. X-Factor, that's another one. The original X-Men make up the X-Factor, and they're a new X-Men now. Spider-Man, Thor, they've been coming out for 25 years. This is a newer one. This one's extremely popular. The Punisher, Frank Castle. He goes around killing criminals. His family was killed by criminals. Marvel used to put out quite a few war comics. This one was Semper Fi, Tales of the Marine Corps. Unfortunately, it didn't do very well, sales-wise. I thought it was a great book, but it didn't sell well. Nobody likes war comics anymore. So that was canceled. But there's just an abundance of Batman comics coming these days. A new title starting this year, Legend of the Dark Knight. That'll be out in October. And then we just have a bunch of other Marvel and DC titles. Each put out about 60 titles a piece each month. So there's quite a few of them here. Far too many to mention. Here's one of the best new ones, Screamer. This is a mini-series. It's only going to be 6 issues. So it has a nice beginning, middle, and end, like a story should. Not like some books that have gone on for 25 years. It gets a little bit, I don't know. I like it better if they begin and end. Okay, over here is where we keep most of the independent comics and the adult comics that are comic-sized. Here's my personal favorite. Highly recommend Flaming Carrot Comics. It's my favorite. 10-year anniversary this year. 10 years of brawling, blasting, big screen action. That's what he says. So there's that. That comes out from Dark Horse Comics, and that's a very good independent company. They put out the Alien comic based on the movie. Goes after the movie, but based on that. Green Hornet is back from the 50s and 60s, 40s even. That's the second issue. That just started out. It's a new company called Now Comics. Here's one of the goriest, most disgusting comics you're ever going to see. It's definitely for adults only. I make sure I see driver's licenses for this one. It's good, but it's disturbing. James Bond comic. Here's the one Grendel I mentioned before. This is one of my favorites as well. Real neat art in this one. And the story's good. Let's see, down here, these comics here, this is pretty much the biggest independent company right now. It's First Comics. They'd be like number 3, but they're a long ways behind Marvel and DC as far as sales go. But they put out quite a few titles. And here's the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, which most everybody has now heard of. Started out as a parody book and sort of became a parody of a parody of a parody, actually, of itself. But it's still around, still going strong. They have calendars and toys and watches now for the Turtles. Down below here have, these are English comics. These are the biggest selling comics in England, and they are sent over here. We get them about 3 months afterwards. We have a lot of customers who are originally from England who try to come in and pick those up all the time. They're pretty good. There's some pretty interesting things. They're mostly in the future that take place. And then, remember, for all ages, Karl Barks, good duck books. Funny stuff, great stories, great art, a lot of fun. And then there's some extremely adult stuff like this here, Black Kiss. This is a new thing here. They sent them already pre-packaged. They're already in plastic bags so that you have no chance of anybody under 18 reading this. There are some very good, very tastefully done ones that are for adults, like this one here, Omaha. Some of these are a little bit gratuitous with sex and violence, like Black Kiss and Faust. But most of the adult comics, when I say adult comics, I just mean that they have just more mature themes. Kids wouldn't be interested in reading them, you know. It's just they're more for adults, not necessarily dirty or violent, just that they are more directed to an older audience. So this is what I read a lot of. But there's good and bad, you know. Basically, the best thing to do if you go to a comic book store, buy what you like. Don't worry about it going up in value. Buy what you like, and you won't get burned that way. If you do want to invest, then the best thing to do is get yourself a price guide and read it through and through. They give you a lot of information on collecting, how to grade your comics, a lot of information on earlier stuff. So make sure you have all the information if you're going to try collecting them, because it's really easy to go out and buy 5-10 copies of a new number one issue that will never be worth anything. You know, your best bet is to buy something that's as old as you are and hang on to it. That's the way I do it. So as far as if I'm going to spend a bit of money, I don't spend a lot of money on any comic that's newer than I am, younger than me. So that's a good rule of thumb, I think. So These are independents, and that's my bit of collecting advice for you. Well, like, here we have Hulk number two, and that's in very good to fine condition. It's $175. Came out in 1964, and I definitely don't want people handling all these. We've got X-Men here. This is the key X-Men issue right here. This is when the new X-Men came in, and pretty much since this happened in 1975, this is X-Men 94. Since that happened, the X-Men have been a number one selling comic up until this year when Batman finally became number one. I like Batman better myself, so I'm happy about that. So there was a stretch during the X-Men all the way up to like 125, where they go for at least $20, up to $150. So they're all up here. Some more older Hulks, some old salvage sort of Conans. They go for about $25 for number one. That's up here at the top. And his recent Batman stuff has really jumped up. All of these books here came out within the last 5-6 years, and yet all of them are quite expensive. And this is the Dark Knight Returns Batman stories. This came out last year. This is the Cult number one. Is only $12.50. Started out at $3.50. It's gone up pretty quickly. These things went up sort of ridiculously this year, and I don't think they're going to go up a whole lot higher, probably. What do we have up here? What else we got? We got Love and Rockets number one. I mentioned that before. This is the adult, mainly adult-oriented comic. Number ones go for about $90, $90 to $100. That or the X-Men here would probably be the more expensive ones that we have up on this side. These go for about $80 as well. I don't think I have anything other than, as I said, we had the Avengers 1 last week. But this Hulk would probably be the most expensive Holy Marvel that I've got at $175.
We here at TPS 35 hope you have enjoyed this overview of the comic books industry. And we would like to thank Dave's Comics and Mark Grauso for all of their time and help.